All right, we are live and direct once again. Mate Mondays, Miguel Anthony live, and I am so excited because this young lady I have with me is usually the one in my seat. She's usually the one interviewing. She's usually the one asking the questions. She's usually the one on the red carpet. But today, we're flipping the script. Today, it's not who she's interviewing. Today, it's about her. Because I've told her this before. This young lady's a star. She really is. And she needs to be highlighted. So, exclusive. I don't know if she's ever done this before. We'll find out. But we got Camila. Studio, help me. Camila, finish it. Toma.
We got Camila Gonzalez in the building, baby.
Look, I could have just said we got Camila Gonzalez. I wanted some anticipation. Did you get Camila? Did you get Camila? Like, we got Camila Gonzalez in the building. I'm so excited that you're here. Let me shut this off because, yeah.
Rule number one of broadcasting. Ay, ay, ay.
I know she and Sandra came in and gave a warning to everybody. Is everybody's phone off?
Oh, wait, mine. Wait.
I checked on our guests. I should have checked on the panel.
Stop it. Listen, we got Toma. Toma, how you feeling, brother?
I'm good, man. I'm good.
On his phone. Camila, how are you?
I'm good. The way you mentioned it, I'm never really in the seat, so I'm a little nervous. But I'm excited to see, you know, what we can come up with today.
You know what? You need to be in the seat a little bit more. Now, have you ever drank mate?
I have.
You have?
It is my favorite thing in the world. It
really?
Is so good.
Well?
Wait, there's actual mate.
There's actual,
that makes
Sandra,
so much sense.
Sandra, can you walk her around? Can you? You like mate?
Of course. I mean, we're in Canada, right? So we get the chance to try things like this. Actually, my first episode of this season was drinking mate with Manny Aparicio from York 9. Taught me the ways.
Sandra, tell her the background of mate, please, Sandra.
Teach me your ways, please.
Mate is a...
I'm sure she knows.
Argentinian, Uruguay, I think Paraguay, Chile, they drink it. It's an herbal warm drink that you carry around your thermos and your little mate cup, and you drink, pass it around to friends.
So you know about the culture. You know,
of course. And like soccer players drink this to stay hydrated sometimes, and you have like the team designated person carrying around the thermos.
Are you serious?
Yeah. It's awesome.
So go ahead.
All right. I'm
do the honors. Here it is. Camila Gonzalez sips mate.
This is so good. You put the sugar in there, right?
She did. You
I did.
It's so good.
I don't
just
like it with sugar.
Just for the first few. It gets
I like
really
it.
Bitter.
I like it bitter, but with the sugar, it helps a little bit to get, you know, the energy levels going.
Ooh, you did put a lot of sugar in there. So, Camila, I'm so excited that you're here with us. Tell us. You have some people with you. Who do you got there?
I have two of my best friends here with
Ooh.
Me. I have
oh, you're on camera.
Lopez in the house, Samantha. So they pretty much are coming with me to different events. Jimena went to the Grammys with me, helped me out a little bit. Sam went to Miss Universe with me.
Let's talk about that. So Miss Universe, how was it being there?
Oh my God.
Miss Universe. Like, this is actual Miss Universe, right? Like,
it's the Super Bowl. It's the Super Bowl of pageantry. And honestly, Miguel, it was the greatest experience ever. I competed in the Miss Universe Canada system, never went to the international. So seeing that stage, seeing those girls, man. Seeing like the judges. I mean, Paulina Vega was one of the judges.
Wow.
That girl was the reason I got into pageantry. She was my idol growing up. So
wow.
Seeing her live was just another level.
Wow, that's amazing. And so let's look at some of these pictures. So you said you've done the Miss Universe pageant. What did you say?
Miss Universe Canada.
Okay.
So this,
talk to me about that picture there.
This was me on my way to Japan to compete in Miss International. So I came second. First runner up automatically gets Miss International Canada. So that was me, you know, with my six luggages on my way to Japan.
What is in those suitcases?
Oh my God.
What do you got in there?
Like 20 pairs of shoes, two evening gowns, dresses for a whole month in Japan. Presents for the girls. I had my national costume in there.
Wow.
Hair dryers, blow dryers. Like, the amount of luggage you have to take for these things is insane. If you have anything less than six bags, you're not prepared.
Wow.
But yeah, that was a great experience. One of my favorites.
So, okay, tell me about your pageant experiences. So you, in 2016, what did you do?
2016 was my first pageant. I was 18 and I did Miss Universe Canada.
Wow.
Came fourth.
Okay.
Still don't know how that happened.
Really?
Like, top five for a first pageant is pretty unheard of.
Wow.
So that was a lot of fun.
Really?
That's amazing.
Wow.
So I got to go to China, actually, by winning fourth place. Went to Miss All Nations, competed there. I came top eight in that. Then they sent me to Bolivia. Then they sent me to Colombia. And it was just like international pageant after another.
So coming top five in your first pageant is unheard of.
It happens, but it's not very common. You usually wow. have to compete quite a few times to start kind of getting up the system. But I went to Colombia. I trained. I have it in my blood. So I feel like I had such a good support system.
That's amazing.
It worked out.
Now, when you say they sent me, do you mean you now have a team that gets you ready? Sponsors that get you dresses? How does that work?
Well, yeah. They is like a very broad term because I do have my team in Colombia. So that's Fabian Chacon. He actually trained Paulina Vega. He trained Ariadna Gutierrez, who are all pretty big names in pageantry. So I have him. He has journalists that train you for media. He has photographers that train you for photo shoots, theater, dance, everything. So they kind of train you in this whole all-around preparation so you can be the best version of yourself. And then here I have like designers. I have designers in Colombia. It's just a whole group of people that believe in you and just want you to do well. So I've been very, very lucky to have the support system that got me to top five. And then the second time I competed, I came second. And then who knows? Maybe I'll compete again.
Are you going to compete again?
I don't know.
Okay. So it's
what
like
is the age restriction? Sorry. Yeah. How far does it go until?
You can compete till you're 28.
Okay.
So luckily I started very young. If I wanted to, I can compete for like the next 6 years. I'm not going to. If I compete, I would compete once. And we'll see when that one time is.
Mm-hmm.
On average, how old are most of the girls?
That's a good question.
I was the youngest when I competed. But usually they're in around 23, 24, 25. They usually go after, you know, you have a university degree. I don't know why I did it at 18. It was like I was in my first year of university balancing that and then pageant training and walking.
But where'd you go to university?
I went to Ryerson.
Ooh.
Rye High.
Rye High. Toma wants to...
I graduated from Ryerson.
Oh, you didn't graduate? That's right.
Yeah. You forgot? Right?
No, I did. Toma actually wants to get into pageantry and...
Yeah.
He was
I've always told him.
And I want him to be my PR.
He's a queen.
I want Miguel to be my PR, but he keeps refusing.
Yeah, so he...
he's got a great look.
He really
does.
Yeah.
That toque and everything.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So what's the training like? You said training. Like, pardon my ignorance, right? Like, in my... please don't get mad at me. But in my mind, I'm like, okay, yeah, you dress up, you put some makeup on, you walk the runway, and you diet for the month leading up. I'm being really ignorant right now.
You got the last part right.
But I mean, like, the way you made it sound there, like, it just... talk to us about the training, like what you guys go through, what these girls go through.
Well, I'll put it into perspective. Miss Colombia is crowned a year and a half before she competes to make sure that she can have dresses ready, body ready, you know, runway ready. So it's about, when I did it the first time, I did a 10-day intensive training because I could only be in Colombia for 10 days. And it was like, you wake up at 8 a.m., you go to the gym, you do an hour of runway training, an hour of theater, an hour of dance, then you take a break and you eat lunch. And lunch is usually like two boiled eggs, some lettuce, maybe chicken if you're lucky.
Lettuce. Were you a rabbit? Here.
Pretty much. Wow. Like, I remember I used to get excited when they'd give me ground beef. I'd be like, yes, it's a good day. We got to eat beef. But it's so worth it. Wow. I mean, then you would go to the gym again. Then you would do some journalism training. You'd be on camera. Then either back to runway training or you'd go to your dresses and try to find different outfits, go to designers, buy fabrics. So that was 10 days the first time. Now, when I compete, I take it a little bit more chill since I have the basics down.
Right.
So, but I mean, training for this, like where this picture is here, for that dress, I actually bought that dress 3 weeks before the pageant. It didn't fit.
Oh no.
So I didn't have a dress because my designer pulled out last minute, went to Colombia, got that one. Wasn't made for me or my measurements. So I had to train three times a day, every single day.
To fit into the dress?
Until that dress. It did not fit the day before prelims. And I called my mom crying. I was like, Mom, I don't have a dress. It's not going to close. I swear, how we say in Spanish, de obra y gracia al Espíritu Santo, like the Holy Spirit helped me zip that dress up and compete. to this day, I don't know if I can ever wear it again because it is just not my
size. You couldn't do some tailoring to it or some.
No, because it was too small.
It was too small.
Yeah. It was way too small. I don't even know. I don't even know who that is. Like, I could not fit in that dress.
Wow.
Like, what size would that be?
I don't know, like a 00? It was made for a previous Miss Columbia that didn't get to wear it on Miss Universe. And you know how Miss Columbias are.
Yeah.
So, no. that waist is just cinched. I can still feel that corset in the back of my mind.
What is your background?
Yeah.
Columbia.
Ooh.
Wild guess.
What part?
I was born in Cali.
Cali.
Okay. Where do you go to the pageant training and stuff?
Yeah,
like, is it to Cali?
No, it's all in Bogota.
Okay, I was gonna say Barranquilla.
Barranquilla has good trainers too, as well. You're from Barranquilla, right?
My mom, yes.
Well, both Miss Universes that have come from Colombia are from Barranquilla.
Yes,
so
that's right.
The most beautiful girls.
Theater. What are you doing in theater? So I'm an actor. So I'm really intrigued by this. What are you doing in theater training?
They're doing improv, they're giving you monologues, scripts, everything. They want you to lose the fear of everything. Like, you make a fool out of yourself for 2 weeks and then you're good, you can compete.
So that you can compete.
And then you just don't care anymore after that.
You just don't care.
You just don't.
You just be you.
Exactly.
Man, I honestly watch those pageants sometimes and they are fascinating. Like, they're nerve-wracking. Like, where's that picture? That. Like, what's happening in that picture right there?
So
talk to us about there. Who's that girl? Why are you holding her hand? What's happening?
So in that picture, that was after the entire pageant was over and they had named the top five. We did question and answer. And then they start narrowing you down. So they say, fourth runner up is this girl. Third runner up. Second runner up. And then if you're lucky enough to be in the top two, you get that moment of holding hands and waiting to see who's going to be the next Miss Universe.
So you're the top two there?
I'm top two. So that's Marta Stepien. She went to Miss Universe last year, got top 10. She won, and then I came second and went to Miss International.
What's Miss International?
It's another international pageant. It's one of the top three pageants in the world.
Which
is where I was on my way to there, mm-hmm. which was Japan, and it was honestly the best experience of my life.
So I know you're not supposed to ask a lady her age, but you kind of gave it away. You said you were 18 in 2016 when you first.
I thought she said it. No, you didn't say.
You didn't
it
say yet? Your age.
No, I didn't. Oh, but didn't. Okay. I guess I said I could compete for the next 6 years. I'm 22.
You're 20. Thanks. Just cut to the chase.
I'm 22.
Listen, I want to be part of your team when you compete again.
Let's do it.
Okay. I don't know how I'm going to fit, but I just want to be part of the team. I could be your
runway coach.
Runway coach. Have you seen my walk?
Absolutely.
Okay. I want to see your walk. No, see
can
your
you
walk.
Actually? Can you show? You can't say that and not.
Yeah,
show us your
yeah.
Walk.
You got to show us.
Make you Miss Canada if I could. I really would.
Is there Mr. Universe?
There is. But it's just not like as big.
Yeah.
And it's
yeah,
very
yeah.
bodybuilding.
Oh, okay.
And
okay.
like Speedos.
Yeah.
A lot of spray tan, which is, by the way, disclaimer, why I have absolutely no makeup and I'm in a sweatsuit. I just want to get that out there. I really would have worn makeup for this, but like I have a trip tomorrow and I need to do a spray tan.
Your face looks great. It's flawless right now. You don't need makeup.
Thank you.
Yeah, you're fine. Talk to us about spray tans. I want a spray tan. This weather is killing me right now.
Right?
I feel like a ghost.
Well, that's why I get it. We're in Canada, right? So I can't be looking this pale. People are like, you're from Colombia? Really?
Right.
Like with that just paleness?
So you have a spray tan person?
I do.
Could you
She's
put me
great.
On to her?
Absolutely.
Does she do guys?
She
do
does
guys
anything.
Get spray tans?
Of course. It's such a thing. And she actually does this really cool thing. She calls it like the Kim Kardashian spray tan.
Okay.
She gives you abs and like a butt lift.
Oh, I need that too. I can use some of that too.
It's all in the contouring.
Exactly. It's like contouring for your body.
Speaking of contouring, can you educate me on contouring? I'm seeing all these videos now of people like. Have you seen this stuff, Toma?
No.
Bro, they're like. First of all, they're like lying there naked practically, and they're like like putting these suction cup things. What is that all about?
Those are so fun. They
I refuse to watch those videos. Refuse.
Oh, wait, I hope we're talking about the right thing. I'm like, this is so fun. Isn't it not just like the weight loss thing?
Yeah, and it's like,
yes. Oh.
My sister's been doing that from time.
Oh, really?
It's been around for a while. Columbia.
Yeah, it's Columbia.
Yeah, Columbia.
So it's very natural over there, common to do that. I need to do that here, too.
It hurts, though.
Really?
It really hurts.
Because it looks painful. Mm-hmm.
It is, but you just got to suck it up.
What does it do? It gets, like, the fat in those areas, like, what does it do?
It, like, breaks down the fat. It kills the fat cells. And then when you work out, you're burning double the amount of fat. No, it's pretty cool. I think it works. It might be mental placebo effect thing, but it works.
Okay, so I want to be part of your team. What can I do?
Well, the
I'm not gonna runway coach. Like
clearly, you can't do that.
Stop this. Like, can I be like your hype man in the corner?
I was
like,
about to say
you got
that.
This, you got this.
Because you know what? We actually saw each other at the Grammys.
We did.
And you were my hype man. Like, you don't understand. Everyone we met, he was like, "This is Camila Gonzalez, Toronto." What were we saying? Hot up in the six.
Hot up in the six.
Hot up in the six. I could use a hype man.
Okay, good.
Right before I'm on stage, you just like
hype me up. Do girls have? Do you need that? Like, I'm trying to equate this to sports.
Yes.
Like an athlete, like a boxer, or like
very similar things.
Is it?
Boxing and pageantry. Yes.
Like right before you take that stage.
Well, I was being sarcastic. But no, you know what? A hype man works. A hype man works. It's usually the makeup artist just telling you like, "Oh, you look so great, sweetie." Like,
right.
But maybe that could be, you know, my cutting edge, my secret weapon, something I have up under my sleeve.
Yeah, I think it's a great idea. So let's work on that. Is there beef within the girls?
You said I could plead the fifth. Can I plead the fifth?
No. Come on.
Fine.
Are the pageants rigged?
Woo! Katoma!
Whoa, I gotta ask.
Good question. Gosh.
Oh, it's like PR girl.
I need you.
Help.
No, listen.
It's like anything, I would imagine.
I don't think it's rigged. I think you usually know who's going to win because there's usually that one girl that gets all the press and all the fan support and all the social media support because you need that, right? Maybe back in the 80s, social media didn't really count.
Right.
But in today's day and age, it's usually going to be the girl with the most amount of followers, the girl that's going to be the best marketing tool, the girl that's going to have the best platform. You can't say it's rigged. It's just the girl who makes sense.
Right.
I like that. The girl who makes sense.
Girl who makes sense.
So that's a politically correct answer. I like that. You didn't even need your PR girl.
She's good, man. She's good.
She got pageantry. You trained to the T. See,
pageantry teaches you that. That's one of the number one things. Politicians and pageant girls. We got the same media training.
Wow. So they train you in media how to answer questions and all that stuff.
Yeah, I'm usually not very good at that because I'm the kind of person that just says what's on my mind. Mm-hmm. Sometimes I can handle it. Mm-hmm. Sometimes I talk too much and then I get in trouble.
What are the girls really that dumb?
Oh, come on, man.
I'm saying it's a cliche thing, you
this
know.
Guy?
Everyone always thinks like, you know, these girls are dumb because you don't really know how to answer the questions. I think it's a show. I think these girls put on a show. You know, they go on there and they're kind of like
No. Toma, put yourself in this position, okay? Yeah. You've been training for this for years. You're on stage in front of thousands of people. There's people judging you. Your parents are staring at you. Gosh. You're on TV.
You're televised internationally.
Or internationally in some cases.
Your entire country is rooting for you.
Relying on you. You have 30 seconds. Oof. And then they put you on stage. You're already nervous. And they ask you some lame question about some controversial politician or something that even the top leaders in the world cannot solve, like climate change or poverty. And they expect a 22-year-old girl
And they can't even play the fifth.
You can't even be like, I don't want to answer this. You have to come up with an answer. Let's do this, Toma. I'm going to ask you a question.
Wow.
Let's do it.
Put yourself in the mentality.
Let's do it. You have 30 seconds.
You're in front of you're in a gown that you can't breathe in.
Wow.
Like this poor girl up there that couldn't fit. You cannot think straight. And I'm going to ask you a question. Hima, give me a good pageant question. Something controversial.
And you've got to answer.
I'm going to try to answer like a pageant girl.
Yeah, you have to. But you can't be dumb. You have to be the smart pageant girl.
So you're saying there are dumb pageant girls.
Yes, is what I'm saying. There are, but it's not dumb pageant girls. It's girls that get caught up in the pressure. Because these girls are so intelligent when you talk to them and they're so smart. But the moment you get up there, you see the flashing lights and you panic.
Right.
Ooh, that's a good one. Okay, so there's a lot of political disturbance in South America right now. Countries like Chile, Colombia, and Argentina are going through civil disobedience.
Oh my gosh.
What should be done to stop this, and who is at fault?
Well, the first thing that we need to do is we need to get the UN involved. We need to get more politicians around the world to help of these South American countries economically, give them a better trade, give them better percentages. The tariffs need to go down to help out these countries. And most importantly, the leaders of these countries need to step up and be leaders.
Okay. Not bad.
You know what? Maybe he is our next Miss
maybe
Universe.
Maybe he is.
Maybe he is.
No, you kept
that
your composure.
Was pretty good.
I don't know how much sense he made.
Well,
I mean,
well, you know what?
Thing.
You know what? We've been
you know what?
I've been talking about this all day. So
okay.
Okay.
Can
and
I try?
You kind of gave me a. You kind of you know when you play softball and you just throw it
so
out
they
there.
Gave you, they,
yeah,
they gave you a gift.
Okay.
Can I try?
You know.
Of course.
Okay.
Let me just put something that Toma did that's a really good strategy.
Mm-hmm.
Talk absolute nonsense, but be so confident. Like, that's my strategy.
Is key.
Just, like, don't let your voice shake.
Right.
Talk and educate people. Take breaks. And people are like, oh, my God, she's right. You play it back, and you didn't even say a proper sentence.
I love it.
And you didn't answer the question properly.
At all. And people are like, yes.
Give me one.
All right.
You got one?
Yes, I got one.
Okay.
Can you
say it in
no,
the...
No, I got a good one.
Ooh. That was a good one.
I got
too.
A good question.
Oh.
Okay, fine.
I got a good question.
Go ahead.
I've got one too, ready for you.
No.
Ooh. Yes, you have to go too.
No, I don't want to go.
Hold on. What was your question? Sorry.
Have you said that?
Say it in the mic.
Okay. Ximena coming up to the stand. She's our judge tonight.
I am. Have you seen the video that's going around with Trudeau?
Shoot, no.
Okay.
Oh, no.
She's already disqualified.
Number one. Fake it.
Okay.
Yes, I have.
So the question is, what do you think? And why do you think it was so controversial about this video? And what would you do as a PR to defend it?
Yeah, absolutely. Great question, by the way. And thank you for asking me that question. And thank you to everyone here in attendance.
She's already gone.
Am I?
Yeah.
That's the worst
30
thing
seconds
you can
are up.
Oh, really?
Thank you for your question.
Yes.
Hi, judges, audience. And then your time is done.
Damn it. Okay. So now remember, I haven't seen the video. So watch how I'm going to fake it. Yes, I have seen the video, and I think it's absolutely terrible. He made a bad choice, but we all make bad choices in life. And I think what he needs to do at this point is just own it, accept responsibility, and move on. The worst thing you could do is pretend like it was like he didn't do. Just accept what you did. You made. I'm rambling.
And the time is up. Thank you so much.
You didn't close, man. You gotta close.
That's my problem. I ramble.
Conclusions.
You gotta close.
I felt like
you're not a closer.
I'm not a closer. I'm not.
You're not a closer.
It's funny you say that. Everyone thinks, oh my God, you'd be great in sales. I suck at sales.
You gotta close.
I can talk and I could sell something, but I can't close. I can't. Anyways, your turn. Go.
What?
No. Yes,
I have
turn.
A good one.
I'm nervous.
Okay. I've got one for you, Thoma.
Let's say these are Canadians. This is a Canadian pageant.
Yes.
So if you were Justin Trudeau, what would you do about the $80,000 jobs that were lost this year alone?
Who's that for?
Who's that for?
You.
Oh, for me?
Yes.
If I were Justin Trudeau, what would I do about the 80,000 jobs? Oof. Having the chance to have actually spoken to Prime Minister Trudeau during a one-on-one interview last year, I learned that he does have Canadians as a priority. And despite all of the controversies that have happened with him, I think the one thing that he made clear to me is that Canadians are his priority. And I think that I am rambling and I need... Can I
that call
was
a amazing!
Oh, that was great!
That was amazing!
Listen,
I'm so impressed.
I'm not going to a pageant right now, so I'm not ready.
No, but that was amazing.
See, you have to throw in your life experience. So
yes.
I have to like kind of flaunt. Oh, yes, when I spoke to Trudeau myself,
it
he
worked.
Said...
I got hooked.
Mm-hmm. He said Canadians are his priority. And I think to recover those jobs, he can continue perhaps his climate plan and find ways to invest in the environment, invest in things that are going to contribute to the planet, maybe in industries where he can create jobs. Because right now, there's a lack of climate change. Oh, my God. I need coffee.
Mate.
Listen, Toma, you're making me look bad. You're making me look bad. But I've got one for you.
Okay, here we go. Let's do this. This is a great game.
This is a terrible game. I am sorry, Fabian. My pageant trainer is going to kill me. He's going to watch me and be like,
we need one for the mate queen, eh? We need one for the mate.
Yeah, you got to get one, too.
No, no, I'm nervous.
No, she got one for
the mate. But I'll go. Rapid fire, let's go.
You know what? I worked with Toma, and he's got a quick wit about him. You can't win an argument with him because he just always has an answer. Can you train me for questions?
Absolutely. I will train you for questions.
So, we all know.
You have 30 seconds to answer. Got to be tight, concise.
I got a timer going.
You got it?
Yeah.
We all know what men can learn from women. But what should women learn from men?
Oof.
I think the most important thing about a man is that God created man first. So, God.
Every woman's going to hate you.
Bye.
Sorry, go ahead. Go ahead, finish.
Let me finish.
That was very rude of me. Sorry.
God created man first. Therefore, he took a piece of his rib to create the woman. So, the women need to know that in time, it's always been like this. And the Bible, the scriptures tell you that, right?
Hallelujah.
So we got to understand, women, right?
And your time's up.
Already?
It's done.
Jesus.
And guess what, Chris?
Well, I was interrupted. I wasn't interrupted.
All the atheists.
Yeah, I'm done. That's very true.
All the religions that the judges pertain to, they're done. You're done.
Okay.
So you're saying judges are not religious?
No. I'm saying if there's atheists, if there's like Muslims, if there's Jewish judges.
You went for the Bible.
You're done. You have to appeal to all religions.
You got to be gentle. Okay, can I answer that question?
Politically correct.
Mm-hmm.
I got one that I think will win me the pageant for that question, for that answer. For that
go
question.
For it.
Okay, can you ask me the question again, please?
We all know what men can learn from women, mm-hmm. but what can women learn from men?
Great question. Unfortunately, I don't feel that there is enough men stepping up to be men right now. And
you messed up.
Stop.
I'm okay. Messed up. You know what? Paulina Vega who got that question? I think it was Paulina. She's the one who got that question in Miss Universe 2014. And she answered it.
Oh, that was an actual question?
It was an actual question. And it was super difficult. And she became a meme because she started off saying like, "Esa es una pregunta muy difícil." And she just stood there. But she said that, actually I don't remember what she said. Can we play the clip? Do you guys edit this?
Yeah, we can play.
We'll play the clip of what she said.
Yeah, for sure.
But even she bombed it. I asked it to Trudeau. He bombed it. This is my go-to question for men that say, "I'm a feminist." I'm like, okay, well then what can we learn from you?
Great segue. There's a picture behind me, and you mentioned it, of you sitting with the Prime Minister of Canada.
Yes.
How, why, when, where? Talk to us about that. So amazing.
So this was hands down the coolest interview I've had the chance to do. I never thought that back then I was 21, still in journalism school, I was going to get that opportunity. This was actually 2 days before Miss Universe Canada started. And I get a phone call and they're like, "You have an interview in Montreal. Like, we can't really say who it's for. We can't really say what it's about."
Who gave you this call?
So this was through TLN. This was through TLN, Univision Canada, the channel that I work with. And they were like, "Yeah, so can you make it to Montreal tonight at like 4 p.m.? And I was like, "Probably not. I'm training for pageant. Like, I don't really..." They're like, "It's important." It's like, okay, I'll make it out. And then they start sending emails about like RCMP and
security. So you still don't know who you're going for yet?
No.
Whoa.
And then I got the phone call and they're like, "Okay, so this is for the Prime Minister."
Oh my God.
And I was just like, I didn't pack for the Prime Minister. Like, I knew I was going to the Shakira concert after this in Montreal. Like, I packed for Shakira. I thought when they said, "We're giving you like a big interview," I checked. Shakira was in town. I was "This is it. The secrecy is for Shakira."
Wow.
It was not Shakira. So that morning, there's RCMP dogs. They shut down the building.
Of course,
we're at our Montreal offices. And I had 24 hours to prepare for like the biggest interview of my life. Whoa. And it was just, I don't get starstruck easily. I was shaking.
Yeah.
And as soon as the interview was done, people were like, "You looked so calm, so serene." In that moment, I was like, "Oh my God, oh my God, oh my God, this is Justin Trudeau. He can deport me if like I say something he doesn't like. Like, he has the power to like exile me from Canada if I offend him." But we gave him pandebonos, almohadas, just like Colombian snacks, because he actually told us he used to have a Colombian girlfriend that he visited when he was younger. So he knows Cali, Bucaramanga, Santa Marta. Like, the whole thing was just so cool because he loves Colombia. He loves the Latin American culture. He talked about immigration, multiculturalism. And then I did like the quick fire questions where I asked them that whole, you know, what can women learn from men? And he just kind of said like, yeah, they can learn men can learn from women. Women don't need to learn from men. And I was like, oh, okay. Yeah, thank you.
Those socks, though. Wow,
I love it. Stylish. It's inspiring.
So how long was the interview?
It's like 20 minutes, 25
wow,
minutes.
Camila, that is so amazing.
It was really
cool. Can we get a round of applause for Camila?
Stop.
Like,
I got the clip, by the way.
You got what?
I have the clip.
Oh, Paulina?
Yeah.
Last but not least, Colombia. All right, so we're going to ask you to reach into the bowl, please. There's only one card left.
Te pedimos, por favor, que saques tú la tarjeta. La única.
All right, and you selected judge number 8, Rob Dyrdek. Your question, please.
All right, well, probably all the time people have asked you, what can men learn from women? But I'd like to know, what could women learn from men?
Probablemente a ti siempre te preguntan qué pueden aprender los hombres de las mujeres. Pero yo te quiero preguntar, ¿qué pueden aprender las mujeres de los hombres?
Pienso que las mujeres, pues, es una pregunta muy difícil.
I believe that women, that's quite a tough question.
Pienso que todavía existen hombres que creen en la igualdad.
I believe there's still men who believe in equality.
Y eso es lo que pienso que las mujeres deberían aprender de los hombres.
And I believe that that is what women should learn from men.
Okay, Colombia.
That was a quick and easy way out. She just said two things, and she was like, I am gone off this
stage.
I want nothing
get
to do with this question.
Here.
Wow. It's another strategy some people do.
Just keep it short, quick, get out.
Yeah, that's what I did with mine. They asked me about equality.
Yeah, what were the questions you had?
Okay. The first year, I don't know why, I got like the toughest question. There was me and this other girl. All the questions were like, what do you love most about Canada? What makes you happy? And then they get to mine, and they're like, if a young person under the age of 17 commits a violent crime, should they serve an adult prison sentence? And I was like, oh my god. I was like, I'm barely the age of 17. So I think I said something along the lines of like, regardless of your age, if you commit a crime that's violent enough to harm someone, you should be punished.
Mm-hmm.
And like, it doesn't matter how young you are, if it was intentional, you should pay your dues.
Mm-hmm.
And then I said something really lame about like, it's all about just like the humanity and your values. And then I started rambling. But it was still like a really good answer in hindsight.
Yeah.
The second one was about equality. So it was, do you think we've achieved equality in Canada? And I know that's such a controversial topic because we have so many opportunities, but there's still so much further you could go.
Mm-hmm.
But to get into that and start rambling on, I literally just said, I was like, yes, we've achieved equality because we can work in the career that we want. We have the opportunities that we deserve. You know, we get the salaries that we deserve for the most part. And with that right, we should fight for equality for all those women in other countries that don't even have basic fundamental human rights. And I was like, get me off that stage. Bye. Thank you.
That was good. I like that answer. That
Thank
was
you.
Good
Thank
answer.
You. Yeah.
How much weight is like, okay, in the judging process, are they looking at, like, what are they looking at the most? Or is it equal? Is it the evening gown? Is it the question that you answered? Is it your talent? Is it the bikini? Like, what, how much, or is it a, like, you know what I'm saying? Like,
I think it's your aura. It's your presence. It's not just one angle of the competition. It's who looks like they already have the crown. Like, who walks, who talks, who doesn't seem to be nervous, who seems like they belong there. Like, if you're watching a pageant and you really pay attention, you can usually decipher who's going to win because a judge has had the opportunity to see these girls for a week. They've had the chance to talk to them.
Oh, okay.
There's sometimes hidden judges pretending to be, you know, a bellhop at the hotel.
Oh, really?
And they see, how are you treating them? Or they'll talk to the, you know, workers at the restaurant that you go to for a dinner. So they have seen the girls with makeup, with no makeup, when they're on stage, when they're just being themselves.
Mm-hmm.
So it's about the girl who has the package, the girl who
well-rounded.
Deserves it.
Right. I like what you said. It's what was the first thing you said? Something like,
it's their aura.
Their aura, and the one that has it already. Like, it just, you know, you just have it. You just got to have that. I think it's fascinating. I think it's very difficult. I have a real respect. Because when you break it down like that, like on stage in front of all these people asking a question, answering a question, like,
I love it though. That's my favorite part. I feel
really?
Like the more people, like this, three people
yeah.
intimidates me more when it comes to answering a question like that than if you have 3,000 people.
Mm.
I think it's just like the career that I'm in and the experiences that I've had. When I have that large audience, something inside of me just clicks. And I love the question and answer part. When you get picked top five, you don't get to go backstage. So the girls are usually shaking. They're so nervous. They're like, oh my God, what are they going to ask? I'm like, ready. I'm like, ask me whatever you want. I will have a politically correct answer ready for you. It is just, that is where I feel at home.
Amazing. Okay, so you work at TLN?
I do.
Okay. And you're only 22 and you're finished school.
I did. I graduated in October.
So, but you were working while you were in school?
Yeah, it wasn't fun, but it was worth it. I've been working in radio. This actually used to be my home.
Oh!
These studios right here. So I was here. I was at another radio from 14 to 18. Then at 18 to 20, I was here. And then from 20 to now on, I've been in TV. But ever since I was 14, I've been balancing work. I used to be a figure skater, pageantry, and school. So this last semester, I was working full-time at TLN. And then I had an arrangement with my professors that I would come into class occasionally or go into their office and then just do a big, massive project at the end of the semester for credits. Because I was working in my career, they kind of...
That's cool. They supported you.
Exactly. Because otherwise, I would have had to choose between school and something that is my dream job.
Yeah.
And luckily...
Yeah, because you're actually living... What you're doing right now is uncommon. Like, not too many people... graduate and then get a job in the field that they studied. So you did you study the journalism? Like
and you're working journalism.
In it. And you were working in it before you even graduated.
Yeah.
Are you living
year.
Your dream right now?
Absolutely. But the dreams only get bigger.
They do. They change. So what's next for you? What's next? You're 22 years old. You're sitting with Justin Trudeau. You're so accomplished. I don't know. I think like the future is so bright for you. Like what's next? I honestly think you can do anything you want.
Thank you.
I think you've got the potential and the drive and you know like to do anything you want. So what's next? What else? What's on your radar?
Well, for now, I am working with the city at halftime on TLN. So I've got that soccer show for the next 2 years. Every single weekend, we have sort of like the halftime show talking about Canadian soccer, about Canadian sports in general. We do some content out in Italy. So, yeah, it's that picture right there, the halftime show. So right now, that's my priority.
Okay.
It's been so nice for the first time in 8 years to have one responsibility on my plate. I think I'm just basking in the happiness that is just go to work, go home, and the only thing I have to think about is work.
Right. Right, right, right.
So right now we're working on soccer. We're working on the Olympics because we're going to be broadcasting the Olympics, the Tokyo Olympics in both English and Spanish. So we're checking out some projects that we could be doing for the Tokyo Olympics. Honestly, right now it's just all about getting my shows up and running, working on the Univision Canada side, going to all these different award shows, trying to gather up as much content as possible, and building up also just the Latino brand. Like right now, there's so much power in being a Latino Canadian or a Latino American.
True,
that I want to work alongside, you know, Univision Canada, that's one of the biggest brands in the Latino world, to maybe make a show or make something that's going to be big and is going to bring our community together. So right now, my focus is just TV, hosting, producing. I do all of the producing, the writing, the research. So I just want to make that as big as I can. Or else I get to live my dream that is, you know, going to the Grammys or going to the billboards and interviewing these people and bringing that content back. And then I get to live my Colombian dream, which is being involved in soccer and getting to interview these soccer players and helping grow as well the sport in Canada. Because we're at a point where soccer is big. There's such a big immigrant community here. There's such a love for the sport, but it doesn't have the same weight that a basketball does, that NFL does, that hockey. Even tennis right now is just hitting this all-time high.
Yeah.
And I think this is part of helping grow that soccer culture and getting more people involved. People that maybe didn't grow up with an AC Milan or an Inter Milan or Lazio, but that enjoy watching, you know, soccer players play different games or learning soccer tricks or getting people involved in the community. And that's what we're focusing on with that.
Do you like soccer?
I do.
Did you always like soccer?
I did, but I didn't actually know much about Serie A, and that's one thing I always say. So I grew up watching the Colombia national team,
right,
watching the Colombian club teams, my parents fighting over like Medellin and Nacional because they're the two rivals. And when I got, you know, called and asked if I wanted to do the Serie A thing, I took it as a challenge and I fell in love.
Like, really?
Honestly, there's just something about the passion that Italians have for soccer and that the fan bases that these clubs have. It's something, it's unheard of. And there's a lot of controversies within Serie A. There's a lot of, unfortunately, racism and political things that go into it. But at the end of the day, the way that the sport is played in Italy, the cities, and they're so vibrant and so committed to their teams that it just rubs off on you. And it's something that I love to talk about.
Well, it's funny you talk about that because I feel like that's what's missing here in Canada. We're not as passionate as they are. Like,
exactly.
We worry more about the basketball, the hockey, and in reality the most played sport in Canada next to hockey is soccer.
Exactly.
So I find that it's really crazy. It's something that, you know, there has to be the Canadian body of soccer, the CFA I think it's called, they have to get together and just take soccer to that next level.
But you know
in terms
I think
of,
it's happening slowly.
No.
It's
no?
a very, no. very slow thing. But you know what the problem is?
Like, no.
I think
it's not, like, but it's not.
It's not where it's at in Chile or where it's at in Colombia or
right,
Italy.
Right, right, right.
One thing that I think really didn't help is the fact that, for example, TFC started doing so well when all of the other Toronto teams started doing well. So like when they won the MLS Cup, that was the same year as the Bautista backflip. And this year they got to the finals. It's the same year that the Raptors won the finals. So it's like they've just been so unlucky. And I think the only way that it can grow is with
the
men's national team.
I think it's beyond. I think it's beyond the men's national team. I think it's a system that has to be created from a youthful age. You have to get, you know, the camps from the 5-year-olds to the 6-year-olds. An example, I have a kid, he's 3.5, and it took me almost 2 months to find a soccer team for him. And eventually we opted with going with the one that we didn't want to go with because there's no options out there. Like, a child, you know, his mind starts, what do I do? You got to put his energy somewhere when they're 3 years old, when they're 2 years old.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And if you don't have that option for him, right, it becomes difficult as a parent, right, to say, okay, am I actually going to support this if they're not supporting the system themselves?
Well, there's no doubt that soccer is not, you know, it's not the big sport.
It is a big sport, though.
No, I'm saying
like
here
I said,
huge.
It's the second most.
Huge.
It's huge in Canada.
Every single kid I grew up with played soccer before they played hockey. The problem is, like, no one knows the right path to go into it, right? Like, you know that if you're in Argentina and you start at a young age, you're going to go through the academy system.
There's a pathway,
right. Here, it's like there's so many different options that kids don't get that dream. They don't get to grow up with the dream to be professional. And that's why I meant the Canadian men's team, not necessarily today, but in the future. Like, how many kids are going to grow up that are playing soccer today that are good, that see that as a viable career option?
Right.
And the problem, too, with the men's team is that it's kind of, you're either all in or all out when it comes to the fans. So when they start doing well, you start kind of gathering a fan support,
right,
everything. The moment they lose, everyone gives up on them and they're like, oh, there's Canada doing it again. Like,
but
we need
to be
there.
But that's how Canada is. Like, an example, the Blue Jays are good. Everybody jumps on the bandwagon. Then all of a sudden, they're not good anymore. They're off the bandwagon. It's not an example, the Leafs. You look at every Canadian team, they're probably the most profitable teams, or they're in the top 10 of the most profitable teams in the NHL. Because of that, because their fan base is so strong. You go to a Leafs game and everybody knows about hockey.
It's true.
You go to a TFC game, it's a social thing. You go to a Blue Jays game, it's a social
thing.
You go to a Raptors game, it's a social thing.
Yeah.
People don't really know about basketball, but they want to be there because everybody is there.
That's right, yeah.
When you go to a hockey game, everybody knows about hockey, right? And I think that, like I said, I think educating parents, educating children, educating the system is more important than, you know, finding who the next best player is. You look at the great players that we have, they're all immigrants. They're not Canadian. They're not generational Canadians.
No, yeah.
They're all immigrants, right?
Toma, what are you going to do to change this? I think you should be.
I have a lot of ideas, but nobody has time to listen, so.
Wow.
We're listening
to
you. All right, you got 30 seconds.
Okay.
Like I said, the most important thing is, I actually got this from talking to a person who does work outside of the country. They actually travel to the Dandoy soccer that's basically for the young youth system. And he told me that the problem is there is no youth system here. Mm. So if you don't have a youth system,
that's true, yeah.
There's going to be no... If a child who's 8 doesn't know how to play soccer, they're just putting them out there to run around and play with some kids. You know, by the time they're 16, it's too late. Because all these other countries, at 8 years old, they already know how to dribble the ball past 5 guys and score a goal. When our kids at age 8, they're just learning how to kick a ball.
So my son, my oldest son, he played for Dwayne De Rosario's academy, right?
My oldest son.
Yeah. Sorry. That's right. For De Rosario's academy, for Dero, right? And 4 of his teammates got picked up to go to the TFC, right? Because of who he is, because Dero has that connection, right?
That's
so,
right.
So we would be going all the time to their training field there at Allen Road because Dero was like, hey, we're going to have like a special camp, and 4 of them got picked up.
But how many kids know that exists?
That's what I'm saying.
Like,
it's only because we were with Dero.
Exactly.
Right. That's
like,
right.
You can have a kid who's amazing at soccer and you don't even think that in Canada he can be a professional soccer player.
Yeah. No, it's tough. No. I
let's work on it, guys.
Let's work on it. Okay, so we got to change. That should be a pageant question. What would you do
to
improve the soccer in Canada? What? I don't know. I'm American. Canadian soccer. Okay, so you're focusing on your TV. You're doing your hosting. You're living the dream. You're 22. I'm excited for you. I'm really excited for you. You know, what was your coolest interview other than Trudeau?
Ooh.
Because you've done a lot.
I've done a lot. Yeah, I'm just trying to think back. Can I do a top three?
Okay, top three.
Top three. Okay, so one of them for sure would have to be Cristian Zapata of AC Milan and David Ospina of Napoli. I'm putting those together because they were interviews for Serie A because they play on Napoli and now Genoa, but formerly AC Milan.
Okay.
They are Colombian national team players. And for me, growing up and, you know, watching them play in the 2014 World Cup, play in the Copa America, play in these things that were so significant for my family and for the country, and then just getting to sit down and chat was I couldn't believe it. I felt like I was floating on cloud 9.
Wow.
So the Colombian team players for sure, huge. Second interview would probably be one that I did with Jane when he was in Piso 21.
Oh, yeah.
So Jane was formerly like one of the lead singers, and I actually got the chance to be his first English interview. We stopped him, started talking in English, and he was so excited.
Does he speak English?
He does. So he was practicing and learning. So he was so pumped that he only has like 60 Instagram posts, and I'm still there on his feed.
Wow.
And like J Balvin commented on it. So many people were making fun of him because he said he was trying to explain a question, and he was like, I think. And everyone was dying. So I love him. I love you, Janet. I'm sorry. And then last but not least, I'd have to say I did an interview with Jayzinho. And I think we all know Jayzinho. He's a freestyler. He's in FIFA 20.
Yeah.
And I just love that interview so much because it was so much fun, you know, seeing these tricks in real life, getting a chance to do the tricks. And that interview particularly taught me a lot about what can be done to grow soccer in Canada as well, because there was a lot of futsal elements and indoor soccer, and I think that's something that's missing a lot in Canada because these leagues keep popping up and closing down,
that's
and these
right.
teams keep starting up and they're gone.
Yep.
And we're in winter.
Yeah.
Like, you can't play outdoor soccer in Canada for the whole year. So talking to Jairzinho, talking to Falcao about you know, developing a futsal love in Canada was so cool, and then seeing it and playing it terribly was so much fun. The more involved I get in the interviews, the more I love them.
So you really love soccer, huh? That's amazing.
Did you play soccer growing up?
No, I was a figure skater. Complete opposites.
Do you still figure skate?
I do, but recreationally, not competitively.
I saw on your Instagram, I thought was hilarious. What was happening in that interview with you and Jude? You know what I'm talking about? I just commented on it recently.
I saw it. I was like, oh my God, he's going to ask me about this.
What was happening in that?
So that was after our interview with Jovinko. That was my first official interview for the Seria halftime show. Okay. I had never done an interview with a full crew where you have the producer, the audio guy,
right, the lighting people. Right.
So I didn't know there was something called room tone, which is when you're all supposed to be quiet and you just get the room tone so you can edit the audio better. So I'm just sitting there after the interview chatting with Javinko, being like, oh my God, I understood your Italian. This was so cool. My producer decides to interrupt us and he's just like, shh, room tone. And I was like, what is that? He's like, shh. And me and Javinko are just sitting there staring at each other for a solid, I think it was like 45 seconds of room tone. And we're like, I hope you show the clip. I wanted to die. Like at that moment, I was like, how do I get out of here? It was awkward silence, like five people staring at us, and we're literally just sitting there like.
But who did those zoom ins?
Well, that was me. I was just making fun of myself.
It is perfect. It was excellent.
It was horrible. I like even put the little things that I was thinking like.
That's what I'm saying. It looked like I was like, did they plan this? Because the way you edited it, it was amazing.
It's another thing. I research, write, edit, hair, makeup. I'm all in one.
You got it. You do it all, man. You do it all. What? Okay.
Hey, we never asked Queen Mate a question.
let's ask Queen Mate a question, and then that. I got something for you.
Okay.
But let's ask Queen Mate a question.
Oh, great.
Can I do one?
You got it. You got 30 seconds.
We're going to pretend you're Miss Canada, because this is probably one of the most controversial questions. So, your country recently legalized marijuana. Do you think other countries should be following in your footsteps?
Oh, got him.
Well, I failed.
I told you.
Keep going.
Okay.
Start over.
Do you think
other countries should follow in your footsteps?
You know, I believe that Canada has now offered the opportunity for marijuana to be legalized.
That's true.
And, you know, this could be good for a lot of people. And I think there's a lot of people that are really liking this new change.
However, are you liking this new change?
However, you know, there are certain things and
it's hard.
Yeah, that's really hard.
It's hard. It's not.
That's extremely hard.
Okay.
Well, that's Miss Canada's platform this year.
Right, it's about
ending the stigma of cannabis. It's a difficult platform though, because in most of these countries, there's so much violence because of drugs that going in and supporting it can be a little controversial.
See, you don't think about that. You really have to think about all that stuff because it's so easy to just take a stance on something and just be you know, like
even religion, like you said, like that's actually something that a judge would be like, if he's atheist, like,
yeah,
you're done.
Yeah. It's so easy to do. I think the big thing with these pageants is you have to think globally.
Mm-hmm.
You have to put yourself in everyone's shoes.
Exactly.
So from art, like I would have never, I just didn't think of that. I'm not saying I would have never thought, like just on the spur of the moment.
But that's why I always fight for these girls that people say pageant girls are so dumb. I'm like, you do not understand. You have to appease everyone. You have to get everyone's point of views and not contradict anyone at the same time. Say something that makes you sound smart within 30 seconds and confidently.
So is it 30 seconds? Is it really 30 seconds?
It's 30 seconds.
I have a question for you. All you girls seem that you're very, very tight during this whole pageant thing, and like you guys are besties and best friends and, you know, BFFs. But what happens after? Do you guys actually stay in touch?
Keep in touch?
100%.
Yeah?
Like you have your groups. There's obviously girls there's 90 of you. So you can't expect to be BFFs with 90 of them. But, I mean, I have friends from pageants I did 4 years ago that whenever we're in the same country or the same city, we still hang out. I FaceTime my roommate from Japan, Miss Denmark, at least twice a week.
Wow.
It's just
so you have to room together as well?
Yeah, we have to room together. You have a roommate. You don't pick her.
They
pick it for you. Wow. So you meet so many great girls. Jimena, I met her through pageants and she's still here. 3 years later, we didn't fight. So it's a sisterhood.
Jimena, what are you hiding from us? You did a pageant too?
I did.
Nice. And how'd that go? Is that how you guys met?
Yeah, so she did it, I think you did it 2015, right?
It was your first year, yes.
You did 2015, I did 2016, and she found out there was a Colombian competing, so she reached out to me, she gave me advice, let me know. You know,
that's so cool.
What happens? And yeah, she was like my mentor for the first year.
You're from Colombia too? What part?
Mexicali.
Wow. Las caleñas son como las flores. What else?
Easy.
Then. I sang the first one. Cali, there's another one.
Si huele a caña, tabaco y brea. Usted está en Cali.
Dun, dun, dun.
Para que vea. Oh,
what a tune.
Feria de Cali is coming up.
I got to go there. And where are you from?
Here, always.
Okay.
Canadian. My parents were born in Jamaica, unfortunately.
Nice. Any pageants for you?
We're trying to get her in. I'm trying to train her. This girl has got this girl has got an attitude and a wit about her that I feel like she could kill it.
Well, when she walked in the room and we said she was very quick, she was very funny. Yeah, you're right. I see
it. She's got it. They would love it.
I like her shirt. Don't change your dream, change the world.
Ooh.
Yeah, it's the Canadian women's team.
That's what's up.
Like that.
So I did have a question for you, and I forgot, but I'm going to remember. Here it is. This is perfect. Speaking about girls, and what is your message? What is your message to girls, to young women, who are growing up in a world where, culture, hip-hop culture, objectifying women, it's so in your face. Like, what's your message to young girls?
Stop hating on each other. Stop tearing each other down. There are so many obstacles that we still have that we can't be our own enemies. Like, you have no idea how many times girls send pictures of other girls to each other being like, oh my God, look at this outfit, LOL. Oh, look at this, look at that. You know, just so much jealousy and toxic environments, and I think we are the ones that are tearing each other down. Like, when women come together at a lot of these pageants or just in life in general, when women come together, you can literally accomplish anything, because like, men are united. Men have like guy code. You don't go to a group of guys and hear them talking about other guys behind their back unless it's a toxic friendship.
Right.
But with girls, I feel like since we feel like we're constantly in competition, young girls use social media to compare themselves to other women, to look at other girls and be like, I want that life. Why can't I be hurt? Just focus on yourself. Celebrate other women's success. You know, that's one of the things that my friend group has gotten so much smaller, because I've decided to just surround myself with women who build each other up and who don't mind, you know, sharing contacts or helping grow each other's careers. Because from a young age, girls need to know that we don't have to fight each other. Just because you're doing well doesn't mean I can't do well.
Right.
Just because the other girl succeeding doesn't mean I can't succeed. So if we really want to take over the world, we need to work together. It. We need to
Studio cheer. You got anything else for this?
If I was on live television,
you're a powerhouse, man.
If I was on live, I would not cut her off. I'd let her keep going. Forget the 30 seconds.
The 30 seconds.
Oh, was this a pageant question? Because I rambled.
It wasn't. But man, you're a powerhouse, man. Like I said it before. Anyway, anything else? Like I could, do you have any questions for her? I feel like there's just so much to give. So I said it before, and I'll close with this again. I think you have so much potential to like do huge things. I love what you just said there, what girls need to do, because, you know, I'm big on that. Like, I'm big on just in general, like, you know, encouraging and like, so I'm an actor, as I said. So I have my agent. I remember when one of my buddies, I put so many people on to agents. And I remember this one guy that asked me, he said he wanted to get into acting. And he's kind of like, he would go out for the same type of auditions I would, right? You know, taller guy, whatever. And so when he asked me, I said, of course, you know, we got him some headshots and I sent him to my agent. And my agent's like, Miguel, you realize that you're sending me your competition. Like when there's a breakdown that comes in, it can go either way. And I said, look, I'm going to get mine. And he's going to get his. And I'm not threatened by him.
Exactly.
There's enough sun to shine on everyone. I'm going to get my parts. He's going to get his parts. And I'm okay with that. So I love that you said that. And I think that vibe that you have. I just think that if you maintain that and keep that. And I think you will. You've got a great team around you. And you're young. You know, like, I think you can really change the world. Like, I really do. Like, You know, I think you can do. I think she can do anything. I think you can do politics, you know, entertainment, whatever it is.
And the
you can,
first female Prime Minister of Canada, ladies and gentlemen. Yo, you heard do it. It.
Yo, you got my vote. Who else?
Until
you got her,
all
you
these pictures come out and they're like, oh, she was on a Swimsuit on stage. Jokes.
Oh, you know, actually, I do have one more quick question. Oh. So, didn't Trump like start the pageant? Isn't he involved in pageantry?
He was the owner of Miss Universe up until 2014. Now it belongs to IMG, so IMG owns a bunch of different entertainment and sports franchises. So Trump was a part of it, and when he started his presidential campaign, he kind of just
he
got rid of it.
Oh, so he doesn't have anything to do with it anymore?
No.
Oh, okay, not okay, at all. Okay.
Thankfully.
Wow. Okay. Well, Camila, thank you so much for coming.
Thank you for having me. This was so much fun.
Yeah, I'm glad you enjoyed it. I thought, you know, that you're always interviewing, so I'm like, you know what? Let's get her in the hot seat.
It's weird. I keep stopping myself from like having to ask you questions because I'm so used to just being like, so like, tell me about you. What do you see yourself in 10 years?
It's about you today. It's about you.
I get.
Yeah, no, thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you to the team. Woo. Thank you guys for coming.
My hype girls.
Yeah, hype girls. And what's that?
No, he's joining it.
I'm joining. I'm not taking over. We're all going to work together, right? We're all going to work together. You've seen a boxer. In their corner, they've got like a whole bunch of people, right?
Yes.
One's wiping here, one's pumping them up. So we'll all work together.
Wiping off the blood.
We're wiping off the blood, right? No, we'll work together. No, but for real, thank you. Thank you so much for coming. And yeah, nothing but the best for you. The best is yet to come for you.
Thank you. Thank you so much for having me.
You got a bright future. Camila Gonzalez, ladies and gentlemen, studio cheer, studio cheer, studio cheer. And then all the baby. JX. De aquí pa' Hollywood. Marchate ya, mi bebé.